Coming up on Oakdale Update, we'll learn about summer events from the Oakdale Recreation Department. We'll hear about the fire training facility and the Code Red program from our fire chief. And we'll celebrate National Public Works Week. Stay tuned, Oakdale Update is straight ahead. Welcome to Oakdale Update. I'm your host, Frank Orsello. This is the City of Oakdale's news and information program about your community. Today I'm joined by Recreation Superintendent Julie Williams to hear about all the exciting events taking place in Oakdale this summer. Julie, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
Okay, let's talk a little bit. Tell us about yourself a little bit. You're from where and you've been here how long?
Well, my name is Julie Williams, the Recreation Superintendent here for the City of Oakdale. I live in Stillwater. I have been with the city for 19 years
that,
now.
That long?
19, yeah.
Oh, good for you.
And I've been the Recreation Superintendent for 7 years now.
And you must be happy.
I love my job.
Do you really?
Absolutely.
Do you? Is your office up at the Discovery?
We are out of the, yep, the Recreation Department is housed out of the Discovery Center.
Okay.
Correct.
All right, listen, you've got so many things going on this summer. What I'm going to do is just mention them and then you tell us about
sure.
them, okay?
Sure,
So how about if I mention and tell you tell us stuff? Let's start with the Farmer's Market, which is just wonderful. And I'd like to know how successful that is, too.
Absolutely. Farmer's Market will kick off actually tomorrow.
Oh,
so,
really?
Yep, first Wednesday in June, and that runs through the end of September. We've got 20-some vendors, some returning, some new ones, so that'll be good to see. But that is from 2 to 5, and that runs out of the Richard Walton Park parking lot.
Yes.
So right across from the City Hall.
That has worked out very well, hasn't
Absolutely.
It?
Absolutely.
Do people... try to get into it? I mean, can you only take so many, or how's that work?
We can only take so many. We do have a lot of returners that come back, and they've been with us since the beginning of the market.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but you know, we're always looking for adding new vendors, adding new things every year, so we look for that as well.
Okay. All right, so we have pickleball lessons. Now, I've never seen it or never, I heard so much about it, but
sure.
I know nothing about it, so
sure.
Tell us about it.
Well, pickleball is a new trend. And it's primarily geared towards older adults, but anyone can play. But we do offer lessons, and those are beginning lessons and intermediate lessons. We've wrapped up our beginner lessons, but intermediates will kick off in a week or so.
Mm-hmm.
But basically, it's a combination of tennis and badminton.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, and I hear it's very successful. I mean, everybody.
Very successful.
Do you have trouble? With space, I mean, do you always have enough room for people?
Well, we do have enough room. What we're looking at doing this summer, we're converting a couple courts at Tanner's Park into pickleball courts, so just designated for them.
Okay, all right.
So that'll be happening this summer.
Okay, now you offered classes, or are offering, or going to chicken keeping. This is getting to be another big item, right?
It is.
Tell us about that.
Yep, really popular. And what we do, we just offer people can come in and listen to our expert chicken keeper. Yeah, there's no charge for the classes. We offer those a couple times a year. So it's seasonal, but people can show up and just listen to if they want to become a chicken keeper, how to do it, if they should, if they should not. So just kind of
informal. Does Oakdale allow chickens?
They do, but contact the police department for all the information.
Oh, is that right?
Yep.
What is it? Anything but roosters? Is that correct?
I don't know the exact specifics, but you can call the department and they'll let you know everything you need to know.
Okay, because I think the roosters keep everybody awake.
That is true.
In fact, I had a neighbor that had one. This was many years ago.
Yeah.
And that dang thing was...
I believe.
He interrupted my sleep, I gotta tell you that.
Absolutely.
Okay, so we have mini camps. Now, what's that all about?
We do. So mini camps will kick off next week, and that's kind of our big summer program. And that's for ages 6 to 11. Those run Monday through Thursday for 8 separate weeks. So you can sign up for all 8 weeks. You can sign up for just 1 week. And those are offered in the afternoon at Walton and at the Oakdale Nature Preserve shelters.
Okay, what does that mean? What's
so the camp is kids come, and basically there's different themes every week. We have a water week, we have a science week, you know, different topics like that. And they do games and crafts and special events, everything related back to that topic.
Who's running it? Who runs that?
So that's our summer staff. So typically we hire about 8 staff every year, and they come in the summer.
Part-timers?
Part-timers, and they do all the programs.
They're probably college kids?
Yep, college kids, yep, few high school kids. A lot of returners come every year.
How many people do you hire about?
About 10.
Okay, you need that many? I mean,
we do with all of the programs that we run. We've got programs morning and afternoon, Monday through Friday. So.
And not only just this mini camp, but other programs too that these people
exactly.
work with?
Exactly, yep.
Are they quite busy?
Mini camps are popular. Some are more popular than others. We do have camps that are full already.
Really?
So if there's something you're interested, get in there and sign up right away.
That's great. Yep. Okay, now another one is pop-up parks.
Right.
What is that?
So pop-up parks, that's a newer program we just started last year. And that's basically just focused on the concept of bringing recreation programming to the neighborhoods. So rather than them coming to us, we bring that to them. So we looked for different parks that were not heavily programmed or they didn't have a lot going on. And then we bring our recreation programs to them.
That's an excellent idea. Sometimes I drive by parks and you never see anybody in them. Never.
Yep.
So, like, what would you bring into a park? What do you do?
So we would bring games. We do special events. So everything would be themed. It just depends, on what we do that particular day. Different sports events, different crafts, whatever day that is.
God, that's great.
Yeah.
How do you advertise something like that?
So that's in our newsletter, and that information goes out to the residents.
In the immediate area then, is that correct?
For the whole city of Oakdale.
Oh.
Yeah, the whole city of Oakdale. So anybody can sign up. With the pop-up parks, you don't have to register. You can just come show up. You don't have to pay. You can stay as long as you'd like.
Okay. So your part-timers and your volunteers, some volunteers, so they would manage these?
They do.
These things?
They manage all the programs, correct.
That is great.
Yeah.
Okay, so then we have family fun inflatables.
Right. So that'll happen on Saturday, September 15th. And that basically what that is, it's a full day of music and inflatables. We've got food. So typically we have about 15 inflatables set up at Richard Walton Park.
And the Oakdale Chamber is involved in that.
They
too,
are.
Correct?
Yep. So what we do, we look for sponsors for inflatables. Mm-hmm. And who is ever interested, they can become a sponsor. And they sponsor an inflatable and they can set up and advertise their business on that day. Tons of people get over. Last year, I think we had 1,500 people stop by throughout
the day.
That's
what I hear. That's what I hear.
It's big.
It is huge.
It is.
Okay. Let's see. And then the concert series,
Correct.
In the Park series.
Right.
So that's yours.
So Nathan Timmons is our coordinator for that. We've got 6 concerts lined up starting the end of June, and that goes through mid-August. Mm-hmm. So lots of different variety every year. And we do something for everyone, country, big band, kids, you name it, we do it.
Off the top of your head, do you know some of the bands that are playing this year?
I don't off the top of my head, but everything's on our website, mm-hmm. www.oakdalefun.com.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they're very successful, aren't they?
They do. They are popular.
Okay. And then Summerfest, can you talk a little bit about that?
Yep. So basically, our department runs the parade on Thursday night. We also do the skateboard contest on Friday night. And on Saturday, we do the 5 and 10K on Saturday morning throughout the Discovery Center in Oakdale Nature Preserve.
Who's the Grand Marshal this year?
Yourself.
darn. I forgot. I'm sorry. I just wanted to mention that. Anyway, and who else is going to be with me?
Jody Christensen.
Jody Christensen, Outstanding Correct. Volunteer of the Year.
Right.
Good deal.
Yep.
All right, now we have one more thing here to talk about, the Vets Fest.
Correct.
Tell us about that.
So Vets Fest will be happening on Saturday, July 7th, and that'll be at Walton Park from 11 to 6. 11:45 is the opening ceremonies for that. Lots of things going on. They've got food, drinks, music. They've got an aircraft flyover, and they'll also do a Huey landing.
God, that's great. What was that date again?
That was Saturday, July 7th.
July 7th, so it's right after the 4th of July. And the fireworks, are you involved with that at all?
That is Summerfest, and that would be through Jeff Kuzling,
okay,
Park Superintendent.
Okay. All right, do we have anything that you want to mention? Did we miss anything?
Just a couple other things that we have this summer, our Amped Up Entertainment Series.
What is it?
Amped Up Entertainment Series, and that basically that's just a free program we do on Thursdays at the Oakdale Nature Preserve Amphitheater.
Oh.
So basically a free, fun family program. We've got five different groups coming, basically U of M Raptor Center, Bug Program, those type of things. And those start at 10 in the morning. Mm-hmm. Really popular. Mm-hmm. Get there early. We typically have 100 people there for
really
for those.
Great.
Yeah, no charge on that.
That's great.
Yeah.
Anything else?
That will do it.
That's it.
Yeah.
Okay. We're out of time.
Okay.
I think we covered everything, and again, you're doing just a wonderful job.
Thank you.
And you know, I wanted to ask you, how do you get these things lined up? Where do you come up with these ideas?
You know, you look at what's trending, word of mouth, what you know, the residents are interested, a lot of feedback, a lot of research.
So people call you and ask.
People call and ask. Lots of different ways we find. Yeah.
Good. Well, you're doing a fine job, and
thanks
for working for the City of Oakdale for 19 years.
Thank you.
Thank you. In just a little bit, we'll be joined by our Fire Chief, Jeff Anderson. First, though, National Public Works Week took place in late May. During that week, 5 videos were produced about our Public Works Department and posted each day to the city's Facebook page. Here's a look at those videos, edited all together, that will give you a better idea of the people who work for Oakdale Public Works and what they do to keep the city looking great and running smoothly.
Welcome to Public Works Week. Each day this week, we will introduce you to one of Oakdale's 4 divisions and give you a glimpse into their typical operations. First off, let's meet the Public Works Director, Brian Bachmeyer, and the Public Works Administrative Assistant, Miranda Williams.
My name is Miranda Williams. I've been with the City of Oakdale for about 2 years, and I'm the Administrative Assistant for Public Works. A lot of phone calls, answering calls, writing work orders. People will call in, problem with something in the city, and I'll direct it to the right supervisor.
My name is Brian Bachmeyer. I'm the Public Works Director and City Engineer for the City of Oakdale, and I've been here since 1989, so I'm in my 30th year with the city. I really see Public Works as being critical to providing the quality of life for our residents. We really address 4 things as part of our community services, with the health, drinking water, and taking care of the sanitary sewer needs, with safety from our plowing operations to patching the city streets and the signing of our city streets, to the recreational with our parks to make sure they're safe and clean, and then also for quality of life and preservation of property values, we have our forestry division, so to make sure that the trees in our community are pretty and healthy, and that our wetlands are also attractive for our residents to enjoy.
Today, we are meeting the Utility Division, headed by Superintendent Sean Nelson.
My name is Sean Nelson. I'm the Utility Superintendent for the City of Oakdale, and I've worked here almost 19 years now. Utilities Division is responsible for the water system throughout the community, the sewer system throughout the community, the street lighting throughout the community. Myself, I take care of some of the safety within the public works realm itself. Going through the winter season, that is our typical, is the water main break is probably our biggest thing that happens. So, you know, we have a lot of issues with the pipes movement within the ground. With the summer coming on, the spring comes the water flushing of our system, clean out all the sediment that's kind of been just sitting there for a while. And then after that, it's on a construction season.
Today, we are meeting the Forestry and Environmental Services Division, headed by Superintendent Warren Cota.
I am the Superintendent of Environmental Services / Forestry. I've been in that position for almost a year now, and I've been with the City of Oakdale 9 years. We take care of the trees, the landscape beds, and the surface water conveyance system, which is storm sewers. Winter kind of went long this year, so we're way behind on all of our landscapes, so I'm busy trying to keep the weeds out of landscapes. We haven't even started mulching yet, then we have to mulch landscapes. Then Summerfest will come up. We'll have to beautify Walton Park completely for Summerfest.
Today, we are meeting the Streets Division, headed by Superintendent Jim Romanek.
My name is Jim Romanek. I'm the Street and Fleet Superintendent for the City of Oakdale. I've been full-time for 30 years. In the Streets Division, we're mainly in charge of the street repairs, street cleaning, street sign maintenance, and then in the winter, we do the snow plowing. And then I'm also involved with the mechanics. We maintain our fleet of vehicles at Public Works and the Police Department and the Fire Department. I just love coming in and helping people and solving problems and getting things done.
Today, we are meeting the Parks and Buildings Division, headed by Superintendent Jeff Kuesling.
I'm the Parks and Buildings Superintendent for the City of Oakdale. I started in 2001 of February, so I've been here just over 17 years. Daily in the summer, we've got, we'll drag and prep over 20 to 30 ball fields every day. We cut the city once a week from the north end to the south end, all the parks, the towers, lifts, well stations, we maintain all of that. I think the most rewarding part of my job is just seeing a project from start to finish and completion and just being successful and knowing that if we're given a task, we can go out and tackle it and maintain it and get it done to perfection.
I'm now joined in our studio by our fire chief, Jeff Anderson. We'll be discussing some topics, including the fire training facility and the Code Red program. Jeff, thanks for joining us on Oakdale Update.
Thanks for having me, Frank.
Okay, so just tell us a little bit about yourself. How long you been around and what's up?
Yeah, so I've been joined the Oakdale Fire Department back in 1978. So this fall I'll celebrate my 40th year with the Oakdale Fire Department, and I've been the fire chief of the City of Oakdale for the last 16 years.
16. Now we have you were full time starting at 16 years ago. Is that
correct?
How did this come about, the full time? Why?
Well, I think, you know, when I joined the department at the time, we were all volunteer. But over the years, as the city has grown and the population of the city grew, the call volume for the fire department just got busier and busier, and just kind of got to the point where it was unmanageable for people in a voluntary situation to manage the department. And then even in the past 10 years now, we've grown to start adding additional full-time firefighters for some of the same reasons.
Mm-hmm. I see some other communities are starting to do that too, huh? It's inevitable, is it not?
Yeah, yep, I believe so. It's just, you know, it's a changing culture that we live in. And, you know, what worked, the volunteer system that worked maybe 20 years ago just isn't working quite as well today as it did back then.
Sure. Now, the EMT guys, now that's kind of a new program too, over the last several years.
Yeah, so the paramedics, we got into the Advanced Life Support Ambulance Service back in 2004 and actually hired our first full-time paramedics. Mm-hmm. So we'll right now we have 8 full-time firefighters, 7 of those are paramedics, 1's an emergency medical technician, and then we have 3 other of our paid-on-call firefighters or volunteers that are paramedics.
Hmm. So you have these people all on duty, off and on. There's always somebody on duty that knows the other job,
correct?
Right?
Yeah, there's always a crew of 2 on duty 24/7.
Sure.
And we're going to expand that by January 1st of 2019 to where we'll have 4 people on duty 24/7.
Mm-hmm. You need it. Is that correct?
Just keep getting busier and busier, mm-hmm. and you know, there are plans for additional expansion and housing within the City of Oakdale, which will just as we add people, it adds problems, which
Absolutely.
Create calls for the fire department.
Sure, certainly. All right, well, let's talk. We had 2 things that I want to touch on. The training center down on Highway 120 and Highway 5. How did that come about?
Well, that program came back in 2012. I was approached by Fire Chief Steve Lucan from Maplewood. They had, the City of Maplewood had an offer made by MnDOT, who owned that property at the time. At one point, it was going to be an extension of Highway 5.
Yes.
And MnDOT had offered to donate that property to the City of Maplewood. So Steve approached me about working as a group to try to come up with funding to build a fire training center that could be used by all the departments in the East Metro area.
Okay. And you were helped by our local legislators, right? Is that correct?
Yeah, so we to get funding to build the site, Steve and I approached our local legislators about getting money through the state bonding bill program. Mm-hmm. And Leon Lilly and Chuck Weger were very instrumental in helping us secure that funding for mm-hmm. that.
It went fairly smoothly too, didn't it, through the legislature? Which
The first year, actually the first year that we had applied for it, so they do a bonding bill every other year. Mm-hmm. The first year we had applied for it, we made it into the bill, but then the bill or portions of the bill got vetoed, and unfortunately our training center is one of the projects that got vetoed out of the bill. Then a year or two later, then the next two years later, when the next bonding bill came up, we got included in that mm-hmm. bill.
And it went through?
Went through, yep. And then the 2 years later, we actually got some additional funding through okay. the bonding bill again to add to the site.
Okay. Now, I drive by the place and it's looks like there's two or three buildings there, but it doesn't mean anything to me. So tell me what's going on in there.
Okay. Yeah, there's actually three different buildings on the site. The farthest one back away from Highway 120 is a mock-up of a residential, two-story residential home with an attached garage. And in that building are a number of computerized props. There's a kitchen fire prop, there's a bedroom prop, and there's a car fire, garage fire prop. And what they are is they're computerized, they're fed by, we can light fires in them, it's actually fed by propane. So the computer runs the flame. We have an instructor that can watch how firefighters, they enter the building, they experience the heat. There's artificial smoke pumped in there. It's theatrical smoke, so it's not toxic or anything. So if a firefighter has a problem and a mask comes off or something, you can stand in there, breathe the smoke. It doesn't bother you at all. So from the safety standpoint, it's great having those types of props. If something does go wrong in there, the instructor punches a button, the fire goes out, the smoke shuts off,
wow.
fans come on and clear everything out. So, but yet it's pretty realistic fire training.
Mm-hmm. Okay, then what, do you have a commercial type building in there too?
So then the next building, the building in the middle, the taller building, is it's a combination that's a four-story tower. So there's a stairwell going up that goes up four stories. And then on first floor, there are two commercial there's a hardware store and a deli, so they replicate a commercial structure.
All these fires over time, it must get pretty dark and smoky in there, right? I mean,
yeah,
how do you clean it out?
Particularly in that building, in the B building, the house with the propane, it's pretty clean. That's the other thing about that. There's not any soot or anything.
Really?
We're just burning propane.
Sure.
In the other building where we're burning, you know, straw and wood, yep, it gets, you go up to the second floor where most of the fires are, the walls are black up there.
Yeah.
Although for training, quite honestly, that's more realistic of what you see when you go into a structure fire. The white painted wall is no longer white anymore.
Sure.
So we, over time we'll have to clean it and we just go in there and pressure wash. It's all concrete.
Mm.
But for the most part, we just, leave it the way it is until it gets to a certain point, then we'll have to clean
it. So do your men go in there with masks on and they simulate like a real fire, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. In there now, because it is actual smoke from wood or straw. So, mm-hmm. They have to wear their SCBA or self-contained breathing apparatus. So they're breathing, I know on TV you say oxygen. It's not. It's actually filtered air. Mm-hmm. So it's not oxygen. It's just we take air from the atmosphere. It's filtered, dried and cleaned and then compressed and put in the bottles. But yeah, that's what they're breathing in.
Okay, so then there's another building, third building there?
The third building is just a classroom building. So a lot of times we'll go out there and you may hold a short classroom session, with firefighters to explain what you're gonna do or maybe show techniques. And then you'll go out to the site and actually practice what you learned in the classroom.
What did you do before you built this facility?
Well, so it was kind of, the closest facility of anything like this that we had was over, St. Paul Fire had a facility over by the fairgrounds off Energy Park Drive.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
The problem a department like ours had is it was, it's a good half hour drive over there. We couldn't take everybody over there to train because somebody had to be in the community to protect the community in case there was an emergency here. So we would take like half our people over there and the nights got pretty long because by the time you drove over there, you trained, you cleaned up, you drove back,
sure.
and you cleaned the equipment and put everything back. A lot of times it was a 5 or 6 hour long night to get in 2 or 3 hours of training.
Mm-hmm. So did that facility, was that shared by other fire departments?
The St. Paul one?
Yeah.
Yes, it was owned by St. Paul. We rented time over there, but a number of other communities did too. But that facility right now, just because of wear and tear, has actually been condemned. So they
Oh, is that right?
The building has just been used up.
So our facility here, is that used by other departments?
It is, yeah. So the name of the site is actually the East Metro Public Safety Training Facility. And, you know, the plan was that this site's available for actually not just for East Metro, but obviously because that's where it's located. The majority of the users are departments out in the East Metro area. Mm-hmm. There's a joint powers agreement, so departments can use it in a number of ways. Number one is through the joint powers. You can join that if you wish. And there we pay an annual fee based on the number of firefighters you have. So right now there are four departments that are in the JPA. It's Oakdale, Maplewood, North St. Paul, and Lake Elmo. Mm-hmm. But then a number of other departments just rent time at the site when they want to use it. And we've got just a real long list from Ramsey County Washington County mainly departments
really?
Are using
it. So, I mean, does Edina or any of those other communities like that, do they ever use it? Or
they aren't right now. And, you know, like Edina is a good example. They've got another facility similar to ours.
Oh.
And theirs is called the South Metro Training Center.
Oh, okay.
So they've got a site down there. But that driving, you know, issue becomes a problem for any of the departments.
But I know I read some of your brochures there, and it seems that you had to light fires and straw and hay and everything over at the St. Paul place and everything, right?
Correct. Yeah, so our other way before we had that was one way of training. The other one was occasionally we would get an acquired structure. So somebody had an old house that they were going to tear down.
Sure.
And we would train in there, and then as a final training, we would burn the house down. But that's gotten more and more difficult to do over the years. And you know, as the metro area has become more populated, pollution becomes an issue, the
sure.
smoke. And,
sure.
You know, we want to be good neighbors, too. Mm-hmm. And so that got to be pretty difficult for us to find those structures
sure.
that we could use.
Well, this sounds just absolutely, is it perfect for you guys? I mean,
it works. For us, it's great.
And
we're
for
other
outfits, too, right?
Yeah, and we're seeing, you know, so it's been in full operation now. This is about the third summer, and it's getting more and more and more busy now. This summer, St. Paul Fire Department just moved, and all their recruit training was out there earlier
good.
This spring, and they're looking to add some more hours this summer. But again, even the departments that have been using it, we're seeing more and more use out of all of them.
God, that's great. We're running out of time for that segment. I wanted to mention to you about the Code Red. Now, tell us what that is. What's Code Red?
Yeah, so Code Red is a system that it's run through Washington County Communication Center, but it's a system that allows either emergency notification or in some cases non-emergency notification based on a geographic area. So you can go in and sign up. You put your address that you want to use, so if it's your home or your business, and then you can put in a phone number. So it could be your cell phone, it could be a business phone.
So you mean me as a recipient of the code, right?
Correct. Yes,
okay.
How you want to receive. So you only get these messages if you're signed up. And you can opt out at any time if you want to too. But mm-hmm. what it is, a system, so police, fire, emergency management, or the city in some cases can use it for non-emergency. But if we had an incident going on, I'll give you a good example. The water main break we had in Oakdale last winter, mm-hmm. they used Code Red to notify residents in the area affected, and they can pick out a certain geographic area and only notify those residents. So I live way in the north end of the city. It didn't affect me. I wouldn't get a call. If you lived near, you got a call. And there was some kind of, the message can be customized to the situation. So mm-hmm. basically letting people know there had been a water main break.
So how does that work? My telephone will ring and then I'll pick it up?
There's a recorded message. Or you can get text. You can select that when you sign up. It can come to you in the form of a text message if you'd like.
Okay. Well, Jeff, you're a fountain of information here, and I appreciate everything. And I'd like to take a tour of that facility one time.
We'll get you down there.
Okay. Do you ever have it open houses to the public?
You know, the last one we did, I think, was a year ago in October. We had
when you had the grand opening, right?
Well, we had that, and then we had one during Fire Prevention Week last year, so in October.
I slept through that one, too. So, but I would like to see it sometime. I'd love to do that.
We'll see if we can get you in there.
Okay. Thank you, Jeff. Right. Thanks for joining us today.
Yeah, thank you.
That's all we have time for this month on Oakdale Update. For everyone at the City of Oakdale, thanks for watching.